Good morning. Welcome to Metro North Church. So glad to have you here today. Our goal here at Metro North Church is that we are creating a place where people are connected to the transforming grace of God. We understand it's not us who changes people, but it's God and His transforming grace. Today our worship is about how we need to have concern for our fellow Christians as well as those who are still being brought into God's family. Our call to worship today comes from Isaiah 49, where it says, "Sing for joy, O heavens, and exult, O earth. Break forth, O mountains, into singing, for the Lord has comforted his people and will have compassion on his afflicted." Let me pray for us. Fathers, we come before you now. We ask you to send your spirit. Motivate us in this moment to focus our hearts on you. May we worship you in a way that is pleasing and acceptable in your sight. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's worship the Lord.
It's falling from the clouds, a strange and lovely sound. I hear it in the thunder and the rain. Ringing in the sky like cannons in the night, the music of the universe plays. We're singing, "You are holy, you're great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you are, and I'm so unworthy, but still you love. Forever my heart will sing of how great you are." Beautiful and free, the song of galaxies, ascension far beyond the Milky Way. Let's join in with the sound. Come on, let's sing it out as the music of the universe plays. We're singing, "You are holy, you're great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you are, and I'm so unworthy, but still you love. Forever my heart will sing of how great, in all glory, honor, power is yours, amen. In all glory, honor, power is yours, amen. In all glory, honor, power is yours forever, amen." We're singing, "You are holy, great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you are. And I'm so unworthy, but still you love me. Forever my heart will sing of how great you are."
As we come to God in worship, we quickly recognize that we are distant from Him, that the things that we are singing about, the things that we are hoping are true, aren't necessarily true in our life, and that we are distanced from Him because of the sin in our life. That's why it's important that we regularly go to Him and confess our need for Him, that we don't measure up. We do that by reading a confession together. This helps us to focus our thoughts, to focus our hearts on what we know to be true. So I would ask you to join with me now as we confess our sins to the Lord. Heavenly Father and King, we come to you today as people who would rather control our own lives than submit to your rule, instead of honoring the wonderful Father that you are to us. We run from your goodness and love toward false hopes of our own desires. Jesus, thank you for submitting to your Father with unwavering faith. You submitted to his wisdom and trusted him completely in all circumstances of life. You ran to him often in your times of need and never turned toward false gods. Holy Spirit, we need your power at work in us. Help us to know and worship our God as he is, our King and our Father who loves us passionately. Press the truth of your gospel deep into our souls so that we see the work of our triune God. Amen. Now, as we come and confess our sins, it's important we know that we truly are forgiven. And God reminds us that we are pardoned. From Psalm 28, where it says, "Praise be to the Lord, for he has heard my cry for mercy. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and he helps me. My heart leaps for joy, and with my song I praise him." Isn't it good to know that when we cry out for mercy, God meets us in that moment? That's good news. Well, we are continuing our series in Colossians, our series entitled Rooted in Christ, and we're being reminded of how we need to have our life, our thinking, our whole self rooted in the truth of Jesus Christ. I want to begin today by asking you a question. Where do you think Metro North will be in 25 years? You know, many of us won't be around in 25 years, and I know that because 25 years ago, a lot of the people that were there at Metro North in its beginning are no longer here. Chances are most of us won't be here 25 years from now. But what will be the characteristics of those people who will call Metro North their church home 25 years from now? Will Metro North be a church that continues to preach the gospel? Will it continue to place a high value on God's truth? Will it have a passion to connect with people outside of these church walls and to bring them in, to connect them to God's transforming grace? In 25 years, what will Metro North Church be like? And more importantly, the question, this is what we want to answer today. What must be our concerns today to ensure that that happens 25 years from now? Today's scripture starts a new chapter in Colossians chapter 2. Paul is continuing his thoughts on what makes his ministry tick. Last week we learned four characteristics of our service in the advancement of the gospel. In verses 24 to 29 of chapter 1, we saw the characteristics of our attitude, the task at hand, the method to fulfill that task, and the energy of fulfilling God's purpose of being disciple makers in the world. Today, Paul bears his heart, revealing his deep concern for the Colossians and for everyone who puts their hope and their trust in Jesus Christ. Now, as we read these verses, see if you can discover his intensity here. What's his primary goal, and what's the motivation for the concern that he has for a group of people that he never, ever met? So join with me now as we read Colossians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. This is the word of God. "For I want you to know how great a struggle I have for you and for those at Laodicea and for all who have not seen me face to face, that their hearts may be encouraged, being knit together in love, to reach all the riches of the full assurance of understanding and the knowledge of God's mystery, which is Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. I say this in order that no one may delude you with plausible arguments. For though I am absent in the body, yet I am with you in spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and the firmness of your faith in Christ." Please pray with me. Father, we ask you in this moment to come through your Spirit. Teach us your word. Press it into our souls as only you can. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Paul's concern for the Colossians mirrors our own. We will look at the intensity of that concern, the goal of that concern and the motivation for our concern for those who are in the church and those who are soon to be in the church. Let's look first of all at the intensity of our concern. Paul says in verse 1 here, I want you to know how great a struggle I have for you and for those at Laodicea and for all who have not seen me face to face. So he's writing to the church in Colossae, but he knows they have a close connection to the church that's about 10 miles downriver, a church called Laodicea. Now, why did he have such a deep emotion for people that he'd never met? I mean, these were people, he didn't plant this church, remember? These were people he had never met. He had never seen them face to face, and yet he has this deep concern. Well, the reason is because he was called by God to be a light to the Gentiles. Paul's stony heart had been replaced by a heart that beat with love for Gentiles. And he's agonizing over their spiritual condition. He's deeply concerned that they know Christ and they are not being led astray from their initial belief in him. How did Paul show his concern? Through struggling and fighting in prayer. Through struggling and fighting in prayer for people that he has never met. In mentioning his struggle, Paul uses the word that we get the word agony for. That's how he struggled. That he struggled in prayer. It was an agony of prayer that he struggled in. One time, shoemaker William Carey, who lived in the early 1800s, he made a leather globe so that he could pray for a world that he had never visited and pray for people that he had never seen. Well, the Lord eventually called him into ministry and led him to India, where he became the father of modern missions. He started schools for impoverished children and a theological school there. All of that was born out of praying for those people, over agonizing in prayer for them. What was the last thing you agonized for in prayer? Was it something just for you, for your family? Maybe the health of a loved one? Do you agonize in prayer for your brothers and sisters to grow in their understanding and knowledge of God? Do you agonize in prayer for your church? When was the last time you prayed for your church or the leaders of your church? Do you agonize in prayer for those who live in this community, those who live in your neighborhood, your community, that you work with, that you go to school with, that you socialize with? Do you agonize for them that they might meet and know Jesus Christ? How might we change? We agonize for these things in prayer. How would our church change? How would our community change if we regularly went before God and cried out to Him for Him to change people's lives? Prayer is where this agonizing toil really lies. Prayer is a hard work. It's a difficult work. And it's a work we don't regularly join into. I mean, we pray. Yeah, but they're so superficial often. We don't spend time deeply crying out to God for the hearts and souls of men, women, and children. You see, Paul was this church's spiritual father. He, along with Epaphras, literally planted this church. Epaphras was the one who planted it, but he learned the gospel from Paul. And it hurt Paul to care for them. It hurt him in the sense that there were sleepless nights. There was tossing and turning. He had concern for the believers' welfare, and he empathized with their hurts and their fears. Later on in this book, in chapter 4, verse 12, Paul writes this, Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ Jesus, greets you, always struggling on your behalf in his prayers, that you may stand mature and fully assured in all the will of God. Both Paul and Epaphras spent untold hours laboring in prayer for this church. In 2001, while kayaking in southern England off the Isle of Wight, Mark Ashton Smith capsized in treacherous waters. Clinging to his kayak and reaching for his cell phone, he called his dad. It didn't matter that his father, Alan Smith, was training British troops in Dubai, some 3,500 miles away. Without delay, his father relayed his son's mayday to the Coast Guard station nearest to his son. Within 12 minutes, a helicopter rescued the grateful son. When we need help, our first impulse should be to cry out to our Father, the one we trust and the one we know can help us. You know, this pandemic has really disrupted our lives. And God uses these disruptions to change us, to drive our hearts back to Him. And one thing He is changing is our prayer lives. We need to take this opportunity, this time when many times we're sequestered away from people, we're not regularly meeting. We need to spend some of that time crying out to Him, crying out that He would use this pandemic to drive people's hearts back to Him. My hope is we continue to cry out to God for Him. He will use us to reach this community. And we will be able to reach out with the transforming grace of God in such a way that people will come to faith. So that's the intensity of our concern. We cry out in faith, agonizing in prayer that God would move. The second thing I want us to look at is the goal of our concern. Verses 2 through 3 say this, that their hearts may be encouraged, being knit together in love, to reach all the riches of full assurance of understanding and the knowledge of God's mystery, which is Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. So what's the goal of our concern? Why are we so concerned for people? Because we want every person to know Jesus. Every person has universal needs that are deeply rooted in the human heart. Each of these needs is ultimately met in our relationship with Jesus Christ through the gospel. Verse 2, he says, we want heartfelt encouragement. We want a unity of love in our relationships, all of our relationships. We desire a confidence in our understanding, knowledge, and wisdom in how we relate to God. Paul describes these three things, encouragement, love, and understanding, as treasures, since their value goes beyond the temporary blessings that we experience in this life. This is what we want, too. We want it for ourselves. We want it for our family, for our friends, our neighbors, our co-workers. Paul reminds us that these are ultimately found within a community and through knowing Christ. Let's talk about living in this community first. We need people in order to be encouraged. We need people to be knit together in love. And we need people to grow in the understanding and knowledge of Christ. Knit together in love. This word means united or instructed in love. We need other people to instruct us in love, to show us where we're not doing what's right, and to confirm when we're doing what we're supposed to be doing is right. You can't be united or instructed by yourself. You can't do it alone. We need each other. We need a church community. You see, false teachers had taught the Colossians that the rich benefits of knowing God can be found without having a relationship with Christ. These false teachers focused on human wisdom. Paul focused on Christ. Theologian Richard Mellick says, God in Christ is the perfect storehouse of real knowledge, and that knowledge supremely appears in Christ. Paul drives these believers back to the benefits that can only be found in Jesus Christ. People today are much like people were back then. I mean, think about the people that you know today. How do they seek truth? How do they seek knowledge? Where do they go? Well, they look to education. We just follow the smartest people. That's the thing to do because those people know and understand. Or people seek knowledge and truth in the most powerful and influential people because we think those people can change. They can make stuff happen. Ultimately, people today look for truth within themselves, which shifts moment by moment with every changing perspective, every changing desire. But Paul says we need to look only to Christ. Verse 2, full assurance of understanding and the knowledge of God's mystery, which is Christ. Notice how Paul is using this to correct the false teachers. He's criticizing them, but he's not doing it directly. He's saying, how does he do this? He's basically saying, if you want to show that a line is crooked, constantly draw a straight line beside it. Well, he's drawing that straight line. He's done it in almost every verse, and that straight line is Christ. He's always drawing that line. He's saying Christ is the answer. Christ in him. We need to make him known. He has the knowledge of God's mystery. Jesus Christ is the full assurance of understanding and the knowledge of God's mystery. So as we draw that straight line, that knowledge of Christ, that's what changes people's lives. All the treasures of wisdom and knowledge at one time were hidden. They were stored up in concealment. But now that Christ has come, they have been disclosed to all who believe in him. Theologian Douglas Mew states that Christ is the one in whom is to be found all that one needs in order to understand both spiritual reality and how to lead a life pleasing to God. British pastor W.E. Sangster was once interviewing applicants for the ministry, and a young man came forth and presented himself before the committee. When it was time for him to speak, he said that he felt he needed to explain that he was shy and not the sort of person who would set the Thames River on fire. That is, he wouldn't stir up the city with his preaching and ministry. Dr. Sangster responded with these words. He said, "My dear young brother, I'm not interested to know if you could set the Thames on fire. What I want to know is this. If I pick you up by the scruff of the neck and I drop you into the Thames, would it sizzle?" And basically he was asking, I'm not asking whether you're going to set the world on fire. I'm asking, are you on fire for Jesus? See, the Apostle Paul was passionate. He burned with a love for God and a love for the church. It is said that when George Whitefield, the great preacher, was preaching, people were getting out of bed in Edinburgh. They were coming to see him. And a man on the way to the church met David Hume, the Scottish philosopher and skeptic. Now, I don't know if you know much about David Hume, but David Hume was very anti-Christian. He wrote a lot against God in his philosophical musings. Well, this man was surprised to see that David Hume was on his way to hear Whitefield preach. And the man said to him, I thought you did not believe in the gospel. To which Hume replied, "I don't, but Whitefield does." In other words, there was something about Whitefield's passion that drew David Hume in. A young preacher came to John Wesley and asked him, "How can I attract crowds when I preach? How can I win people the gospel?" is what he's saying. Wesley responded, "Get on fire for the Lord and people will come to watch you burn." That's what's missing today, not just in our church, but in the world. And I'm including myself on this, but we're not on fire for Jesus. We're not passionately consumed by him. When you become passionately consumed, when you come on fire for Jesus, people notice there's something different and they want to know. They'll come just to watch you burn. We need to plead with God. We need to go before God in agonizing prayer and say, "God, I need you to ignite me. Change me. Don't make me a fanatic, but make me someone who is passionate about you." We will be motivated to act. So Paul's great passion was for people to know all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge, which is Christ. So I have to ask you, how are you growing in your understanding of Jesus Christ? Are you engaged in any type of Bible study to understand and grow and know more about Jesus? Are you involved in a life group or other small group where you can engage with people who can encourage you in your understanding? Maybe you're doing a personal Bible study that builds you up, that creates in you a new passion for Christ. We all need to regularly be involved in that type of learning. So the intensity of our concern is revealed in how we pray. The goal of our concern is that we might know the full knowledge and wisdom, which is Christ, and it may passionately burn in us. Now let's look at the motivation for our concern. Verses 4 and 5, he says, I say this in order that no one may delude you with plausible arguments. For though I am absent in body, yet I am with you in spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and the firmness of your faith in Christ. What motivates us to be in involved in God's great plan for humanity? Well, there's several things. I'm going to mention three here. First of all, we want people to know the truth. Paul states it here this way, that no one may delude you with plausible arguments. We want people to know what's true. We don't want them to be led astray by other arguments. Paul's concern here with fast, smooth talkers who took the focus off Christ to create a powerless, worldly wisdom. Plausible arguments is the word which literally means parallel words. So someone is speaking into your life with words that go right beside what you believe. They're parallel words. They look right, they sound right, but in the end, they are false and they lead you astray because they have no power. They have no power. Paul wants them to focus on Christ. Only Christ has the power to change the human soul. The second thing that motivates us to be involved in God's great plan for humanity is we have to remember we're not alone in this endeavor. Paul says, I am with you in spirit. Now, Paul's not saying, you're in my thoughts and prayers. That's not what he's saying, but I'm with you in spirit. In spirit here means we have this bond. This bond that comes from being united in the body of Christ. We are united by His Holy Spirit. We have the bond of the Holy Spirit between us. We have a kinship with every believer around the world and throughout history because of the Holy Spirit. Have you ever met a stranger and through a brief encounter of talking with them, even a short dialogue with them, you get a sense that they are a Christian? I had this happen at the checkout line at a Walmart one time. Just the joy that this lady was exuding and her graciousness to me. And I even asked her at the end of our interchange, I said, are you a Christian? She smiled and said, yes, I am. I said, well, may God bless you. You have a great day. We have a kinship. We're not alone. We're one in spirit. What motivates us to be involved in God's great plan for humanity? We want people to know the church. We have a bond of the Spirit. And then thirdly, we take great joy to see believers living securely by faith in Jesus Christ. He says here, rejoicing to see your good order and the firmness of your faith in Christ. These words used here are often used of a military. When you think about the troops coming out, set in array, you know, lined up, all looking the same, all at attention. You're in good order and firm in your faith. So Paul here, he's not calling their salvation in question, but he's filled with joy knowing that despite the wrong teachings that they've been hearing, they're holding their ground. They're in good order. They're firm in the faith, secure in their belief in Christ. Isn't that what we want for ourselves? Don't you want your life to be in good order? For you to be firm in the faith, that the circumstances of life don't sway you, disrupt you? Isn't that what we want for our children? We want them to know the truth. We want them secure in the faith. And then to know they're not alone, that they have a church family, and they have Christ Himself through His Spirit always with them, guiding, comforting them. Jesus' final command to us as His followers was to go and make disciples. And we focus usually, when we read that scripture, we focus on the go and make disciples point. And we lose quite often the two promises that God gives us that bookend that. That going and making disciples is sandwiched between two wonderful promises. The first one says this, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. That's Jesus talking. He says, look, I've got all authority. I'm in total control. Nothing happens without me giving a say-so on it. I'm in total control. Now go and make disciples. So that's the first promise. God is in total control of all things. But then at the very end, he says, and behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. So not only am I in total control, but we're not alone. We don't go just by ourselves. We're going with Jesus himself, his spirit. So he's saying, I have all authority. I'm in total control. Don't worry. Nothing has escaped my gaze. My hand is resting on every event in your life. And don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. I am with you, even to the end of the age or for all time. We can be encouraged. We can have a great concern that agonizes in prayer, that longs for people to see and know the deep treasures of understanding Christ. And we can take great joy being motivated because we know that we have the truth and Christ is with us in this endeavor. Let's pray. Father, we come before you. Father, may you burn in us, develop in us a passion for the lost, a passion to see people grow in understanding, a passion for your word. Jesus, we know this is a spiritual work and only you can do it, but we cry out and we ask you to come in power into our lives. Change us. May you use us in a mighty way, right where we live, right where we work. Help us, Father, to reach the world for you and by your Spirit. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the dark. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord, and it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, we pour out. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. You give life, you give life, you are love, you bring light to the dark. Every heart that is broken, great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour. You only. And all the earth will shout your praise. The hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. It's
as always, as you go, I want to give you a word of encouragement. It's called the benediction, the good word from God. Here's God's good word for you today, and it comes from the book of Jude. It says this: Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forevermore. Amen. Go in that grace. May you have a great week in the Lord.